And also want to thank our most highly esteemed Papa Joshua Aguila. Amen. Amen. Say thank you, Papa.
Thank you, Papa.
Amen and amen. Amen. Also want to thank our most highly esteemed Mama Yemisi Joshua Aguila. Bless her, Mama.
We love you, Mama.
Amen. And also we're glad to see Pastor Yunis at the headquarters here. Amen. Let's the Pastor Yunis we love and do.
We love you, Pastor.
Praise God. Amen. Amen. So you see, we're creating maximum impact, right, from America. Yes. All right, so today we want to continue from the subject we began on, the I am. Say the I am.
The I am.
And Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. Because this God we say we serve, who is he? What do I really know about this God? Or what makes him who he is? And have you ever thought of it? How do I even know that the God I'm serving is the God of the Hebrews? What makes you think that when somebody is called to lead praise or worship, and the person is saying, the ocean divider, the ancient of this, the I am that I am. What makes you think that's probably the God you're serving? Someone say, he is because he never changes. How do you know? Someone say, God does not change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You lie. You just told a lie. Because it is Jesus Christ that was said is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Someone said, but the Bible says, I am God, and I change it not. Really? Was he saying that to everyone? Because from scriptures, God does change. There's proof that God's changing. Now you look funny, but God does change.
Wow.
I mean, he said, to the merciful, he will show himself merciful. See? To the pure, he will show himself pure. So that means the way God relates with the pure is not the same as the way he relates with the merciful. Then he now said, to the crooked, fraud, he will show himself crooked. If that is what you say about God that does not change, then I agree. But to say God is just one fist and does not change. I mean, if you can say, Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated, that will tell you that he changes. His disposition towards everyone is not the same. See?
I see.
So which means he changes, his change is actually determined by the individual. You see, the truth of the matter is that God is not the actor. He's only a reactor. You and I are the actors. And what God does is that he reacts based on how we act. And the reaction could either be positive or negative. In fact, prayer, say prayer.
Prayer.
Prayer is a proof that God is a reactor. Yeah. Because until you pray, he will not do anything. At least to an extent. So God reacts. He says to the merciful, he will show himself merciful. So, the way God Almighty describes one as a merciful person is by the way God shows the person mercy. Yes. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
Which means the way God defines mercy is not the same as the way man defines mercy. Everyone, a man may have done wrong, and God still says, I will show him mercy because he's a merciful person.
Yes. Yes.
While others are clamoring for justice,
right.
Let's save this man, justice. Let's save this woman, justice. God says, no, this person is a merciful person. And when you ask the Lord, why do you see this person as a merciful person? In fact, God can tell you, 2 years ago, I saw him give a quarter to someone who was asking him for quarter. It's amazing what God values in a man. And he can hold on to that. Because you passed by the same drug guy and said, no, if you give him money, he'll go and use it to buy drugs. The other guy didn't think about that. He gave him. So you see, God changes. But who determines the change?
Me.
You. I. So the next time, before you want to rule off someone out of your life, think about how God will see that decision you're about to take. Could it be that that decision you're about to take, God himself is going to do the same to you? Because you can't take that kind of decision and now say to the Lord, show me mercy. God says, no. God, even God will say, I cannot. Because you've already decided. You've already taken a decision. This now will help us become careful in the way we take decisions. I just wish even judges in court, beyond the evidences provided, can still look beyond the evidences to see whether one deserves the mercy. Or you, the boss, do you think someone deserves to be fired? And before you were even considering firing the person, did you think about the fact that this person probably has a family?
Yeah.
And the little children are innocent, they are all in school, coming home to see daddy at home, watching TV. Daddy has no job because another man fired him. And God says, okay, let me do the same. And God waits when your children are entering college. That's when you were now fired. Because God knows how to reward good. And God does not measure his reward. When he wants to reward you, the Bible says, John said, he is able to do. Paul said so, he is able to do exceeding abundantly. But 3 John, he says, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in good health. Right? Then he says, behold what manner of love the Father has given. The word given is the Greek word lavished upon us. That means God doesn't know how to measure. So if he's going to show the merciful mercy, he will lavish mercy. So that the person can become what? More merciful. And the more merciful you become, the more God shows you mercy. See? And you, the merciful one, and you that is enjoying God's mercy, don't think you are pure. Do you understand? He says to the pure. is English. They are not the same. That you need mercy meant that you were very guilty, far from purity. And so don't ever mistake mercy for purity. Lord, have mercy upon me.
Lord, have mercy upon me.
I know you are pure, but Lord, have mercy. You look pure. Aren't you pure? Some of you laugh. Okay, now. The reason why we said what we said is simply because there's need for us to know which God we're serving. Are we serving the God of the Hebrews? And if he's the same God, are we expecting him to relate with us the way he related with Moses? And is that the reason why you called him I am that I am? So that he can move on your behalf, yet you are not Jewish. Have you ever thought about it? Even the disciples, not even Jesus, will praise God and say, the I am that I am.
Wow.
Because they knew what that expression, I am that I am, means. Aye, Asha,
Aye.
Aye, Asha, Aye means what? Act deadly, act. The one who acts deadly. The one who is deadly. Altogether deadly. Of all things, you a product of grace. How can you say you want to worship God and you are saying, I am that I am? Could it be that you are reminding him that you deserve judgment? Because you are under his grace. Now you are saying, the I am that I am. And he said, who said that? It is because many don't know what I am that I am means. Because if you do, you will never, never mention that expression. And you will not be angry that you did it. Because it's not for you. Even when he brought the children of Israel out of Egypt, you will never see where they said, I am that I am, I worship you. Never said it. The only person that knew God, the Elohim, as I am that I am, was Moses. He wrote about it. And that is why in our last class we began to tell you, when you hear somebody say, I call on the God of Papa Joshua Egila. Well, first of all, do you know that God? Or you know Papa Joshua Egila? He is the one you know. And if the God of Papa Joshua Egila is ever going to look at your direction, he can only look at you through his eyes, through the eyes of Papa Joshua Egila. That is why, like our Papa when he's ministering, he can look at you and say, stand up. There's a message for everyone in church, but he chooses who to minister to. He chooses.
Wow.
Because there are occasions where the Spirit of the Lord can say, I want you to minister to him. Because he says the spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet. That means the ministry spirit of the prophet is answerable to the prophet at that point. So if Papa says, no, I don't like, isn't it amazing? Papa may want to minister to someone and the person does not answer. Then he says, I'll leave you. See, you understand? So the point here is that if God or Papa Joshua Egila is ever going to even look at your direction, he's going to do it through Papa Joshua Egila. So which means if Papa Joshua Egila does not approve of you, the God of Papa Joshua Egila will not look at you.
That's right.
Wow. How come
God was reporting King Saul to Samuel the seer? Yet King Saul had a biological father because it was Samuel the seer that made him. Samuel the seer ordained him. So God was looking at the matter through the eyes of Samuel the seer.
And somebody say, I said to King Saul, when you were nothing. And God didn't say, why did you say that? Do you know he's king? Somebody say, I said, you were nothing. God sent me to ordain you king. So the point here is, it sounds nice to say, I call on the God of Papa Joshua Egila. First of all, do you know the God of Papa Joshua Egila? Or you know Papa Joshua Egila himself? So the thing is, why don't you relate with Papa Joshua Egila himself? Then from there, you can become recommended. You see, Paul said it in Acts chapter 20. Remember?
Yes, sir.
From verses 17 to 32. Mm-hmm. Acts 20, verse 17 to 32. He says, I recommend you to God. He was talking to the pastors in Miletus. He said, I recommend you to God and to the word of his grace. To God and to the word of his grace, which is able Amen. To build you and give you an inheritance.
Amen. I receive.
Who did the recommendation? Paul the apostle. Mm-hmm. And Paul said to them, everything you ever knew, I taught you. Now, I want to recommend you. Now, these were already ordained pastors.
Yes, sir.
He said, now, let me recommend you to God.
Amen.
It's amazing. There is an order. See, there are many things people do, Christians do in ignorance, that God does overlook. Okay. The last time there was a program, did you give for it? And it was a program Papa Joshua Egila was coming to minister in. It was his program. You did not give to the program, yet you are calling on the God of Papa Joshua Egila to answer you. When the God of Papa Joshua Egila saw that you did not give. So how can you call on the God of Papa Joshua Egila? Okay, when Brother Elsie said, sister, help us do this thing, and you didn't do it, or you did it at your own convenience when it was urgent, what makes you think that the God that produced this says was not the one who said you should do that thing so that you can be marked? But you didn't. Now you are calling on him for help.
Wow.
Someone said, but I know God is a merciful God. Yes, he is, but you are crooked. So he will not show you mercy. He will show you crookedness. Someone said, God cannot lie. He cannot lie to me. He cannot lie to me. How do you sing this song? The Lion of Judah, he cannot lie to me. Well, he has lied to you. He has lied to you. Because if you say he cannot lie to you, what are the proofs? What are the proofs that he cannot lie to you? Give us proofs. Let's see that the God you are serving cannot lie. Or is it because you sang it because choir leader sang it? You know, there are some songs, even for you to sing them, you should even ask yourself, yeah, I know I'll be pretending. But there is there's somebody who is saying, he cannot lie to me. And you know that you know with evidence that of the truth, God does not lie to these ones. Whatever he says, he will do.
Pastor Christian.
See, what did you have doubt for? What was the last thing you had doubt for? Even though it was the word of the Lord to you, what was it you had doubt about? They told me, I received prophecy the last time. This is going to happen. I'm yet to see. I'm still waiting, no. I'm still waiting. I know my God cannot lie. No, he already lied. He already lied. Because you already proved him to be a liar. He said they told you. Yet you were the one shouting, I receive. With your hand and your leg. Oh, Oh, I receive. Now you say it cannot lie. But even your disposition can show us that you are acknowledging he lied. And God did lie to you. So say, no, prophecy cannot be a lie. Who told you? Who told you? 2 Chronicles chapter 18. Was it not the prophets that prophesied to King Ahab that he was going to take over Ramoth Gilead? So was it, those were satanic prophets. They were not satanic prophets. God approved of the prophecy. It was a prophecy coming from God through a lying spirit in the mouth of the prophets. Why? Because King Ahab was a very insincere person. He preferred lie. That was his life. He appreciated lie more than truth. Right? Micaiah the prophet came to tell him the truth. Even when Micaiah the prophet lied to him, he was angry. He said, Micaiah, how many times would I want you not to lie to me? So Micaiah said, okay, fine. Let me tell you the truth. If you go to Ramoth Gilead, you will not come back alive. He said, lock him up. You see what I say? I don't like this guy. He's always prophesying Baba prophecies to me. So King Ahab knew what the truth was.
Wow.
He knew. You see the kind of life he lived? He was a king that vacillated in his mind. He was somebody who was a flip-flop person. And that kind of person, how can you tell him the truth? He will query the truth. And if you lie to him, he will be angry that you lied. And if you tell him the truth, he will be angry that you told him the truth. God says, look, it's better, it is with lie that this guy can flow. You see, God changed towards him. So we say, is God still holy in that condition? Well, he is. Why? Why would you say God is holy? He's holy because you determined his change. You see. You need to understand that in some people's lives, God is like a thermostat. You are the one to set it. You understand?
Yes, sir.
But in some of our own lives, we are God's thermostat.
Yes. Amen.
God controls our lives.
Amen.
And you know, when God Almighty becomes someone you can control, you have made him a talisman.
Yes.
You have made him a charm. Paul said that to the Corinthian church. I know my God cannot fail me. So the thing succeeded. So he said, I know it. I know God hears me all the time. But look who is talking. Now, the danger about that is, what have you made of him? He is God, a talisman to you. And he will gladly be, if that's what you want. See, the way you live your life determines what God will be to you. So, Exodus chapter 3. Let's read something from verses 1. He says, now Moses, can we read together, was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law. Can we read on? The priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. Now, what did we tell you Horeb means? Horeb means waste. Not even green pasture. Waste. Because of course, it's a place you not even want to consider to go to. It would be strange for somebody like you to come to a place of waste and find God. Tell me, is it? Whether you like it or not, angels like desert places. Isn't it amazing that it was in the wilderness? Two angels came and ministered to Jesus after the temptation. Not in a greener pastures. See? Some people, when they are going through the wilderness experience, that's when they say they need a psychologist. I just need, then the man says to the woman, You are supposed to be there for me. Wait, is it because she married you that she is the reason why she has to be there for you?
No.
Was she always there for you? Well, she should be there for me now. Why do you think she should be there? Because I married her. Really? See how selfish you are. Okay, fine. She is there for you. You want her to be there for you. Has she been able to change the circumstance? Because it's one thing for me to be there for you. It's something I hardly say to people. I don't really say to people, I'm there for you. I don't think I've ever even used that expression. I don't think I've ever said that to any human. That if you need me, I'll always be there for you. That's too costly to say, even as a Christian. I just know what is within my capabilities I will do for you as the Lord enables me. But to say, I'll always be there for you. What if I'm in Sokoto and you need my help in Connecticut? And I'm not, I may not be able to be there. And let's not fool ourselves. There are just some circumstances you may not. Put your marker here. Go to Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. See why I'm a success forever.
I'm a success forevermore.
Well, you don't sound like you're being.
I'm a success forevermore.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
In Revelation chapter 2. When you read from verses 8, the Lord was talking to the angel of the church of Smyrna. And when you read from verses 10, in fact, let's read from verses 9. I know your works, tribulations, and poverty, but you are rich. And I know the blasphemy of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Now, verse 10 is the part I want you to see. It says, do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. You listen to that? That means that there are sufferings that you can never change. Prayer will not do it. You will just only be punishing yourself to pray about it. It says, do not be afraid of the suffering that you are about to go through. Now, want to find out where that suffering is going to come from. Read it. Indeed. Come on, look into your Bible. Now, don't pretend to be sleeping. Now, do you understand? Please. Well, I read now. Indeed. Come on now, let's read. Indeed, the devil is about to throw you into the prison. Pause. Now, he's telling us here, there is a devil you cannot cast out. There's a devil that can throw you into prison. I believe it is the same devil that apprehended the angel in Daniel chapter 10 that locked him up. There is a devil that one may not be able to cast away. That one, even your own righteousness from God cannot save you from the hand of that one. That one has a right to throw you into prison. Do you understand? May you not cross paths with that kind of devil.
Amen.
But there is such a devil that has the ability. You may say, get out in the name of Jesus. I rebuke you. You say, look at this one. You are just wasting time. Call Prophet Boniface. Tell him, I'll give him $200. Let him go on 3 days dry fasting. Call Prophet McIntosh. Let him pray for me concerning the mind of the judges. Call Reverend Rashida, tell her, He says the devil is about to throw you into the prison. Now, if the Lord is now this is what God Almighty is telling a church. He's saying there's an attack that is coming where all of you will go to prison. Church will be closed down. Yeah? And he didn't say, I will not let that happen. See what he said? He says, that you may be tested. And you will have what? Tribulation 10 days. The word 10 days there means 10 years. Now, you think the Lord will say, okay, I will deliver you even in the first few hours. That means that there is a prison the devil can throw a man into. Bail will not work. Bail. That prison is a prison for 10 years. Now, notice, these people, look up, please. This particular church, they are already used to tribulation. Do you understand? Yeah. They are already used to poverty. The Lord said, don't worry, you are rich. It's in bracket. Do you understand? Yeah. And so, you see why it's not good to be poor? Yeah. Because they are poor. The Lord said, Satan will use people as litmus test. A specimen, poverty, because they are so used to suffering and poverty. He said, Satan will use you before as experiment. He said, he will test you. See that? It's not good to be poor.
Yes, sir.
I'll never be poor in my life.
I'll never be poor in my life.
Never be poor in my life.
I'll never be poor in my life.
That means this kind of Christians, they will not be able to hire a lawyer, an attorney. They will not be able to do so. Now, he says, indeed, the devil is about to throw you, to throw some of you, not all, into prison. Now you are denying. This is the Lord talking. That you are saying, not you now, you have been disobedient. He's telling you. He said that you may be tested and you have tribulation for 10 years. Because you're already used to poverty. You see why it's not good to be used to poverty?
Wow. Okay. Yes, sir.
Now, read the next thing. Did the Lord say, I'll come and deliver you?
No.
What did he say? Come on, read now. You are not reading. Let's close. He says, be faithful unto death. Oh man. What a wasted life. Then the Lord says, well, when they die, he'll give them crown of life. Meanwhile, there's another church that has received their own crown of life while they are still alive. These ones that are used to suffering, he says they will receive crown of life when they die. And since you don't want riches, go to prison. You understand? Yes. So here, he's telling us why God would not waste heaven's resources to go and deliver such a Christian. God will not waste the resources of heaven to go and deliver a Christian that is poor. God will not do it. Yeah. I'll never be poor in my life.
I'll never be poor in my life.
So they say, brother, how manage? Have you ever seen some people with big sores on their feet?
Yeah.
Sore. How do you pronounce sore in America?
Sore.
Pronounce it again.
Sore.
Sore. Injury, we mean. Wound.
Yeah.
They have had it for many years. The sore, the wound, the injury, it looks so ugly. Oh, yes, but how long have you, for 2 years now? For 2 years, two Christmases, January to December. Did you ever sleep? Oh, yes, I sleep. Why? Well, I've become used to it. See, they have become used to pain. You see what Jesus said? Let's use them. I know you are a Christian. Let's Satan, use this one as an experiment. Did you notice? Before the devil could attack Job, he had to be poor first.
Yeah. Wow.
He had to be poor first before Satan attacked his body. See that? Because Satan couldn't attack. He said, have you not blessed him with everything? So Job had to be broke first before Satan attacked his body. Because the people came telling Job that all his businesses were destroyed. Yet he did not go out to see the businesses. And he was broken emotionally. And that affected his health. The Lord had to beg for his life. He said, spare his life. It's not good to be poor.
I've seen the
face of poverty, but I'll never be poor again.
I'll never be poor in my life.
I ate rotten food for 10 years. Rotten food. You understand? Recently in the house, that was 3 days ago, our folks cook rice, nice rice, beautiful rice. But because we left home early, fried rice. Our food, I don't know why it gets spoiled on time. By the time we got home now, the food was spoiled. So our folks now, with the anointing they have, they tried to heal that rice.
Yeah.
By putting it on the fire, as though they are sanitizing the rice. So they put it, decorated it in the plate and brought it to us because we're very hungry. When we tasted that rice, I said, this rice is sports now. And they say, we. It's a gourmet rice. The gourmet. They massage the rice with fire. Then put meat on the side. It was a temptation. When I saw the meat, I thought the rice was good. But when I tasted it, I said, this thing is sport. I could have eaten it. But eating it would take me back to Egypt. So I said, I'm not eating it. Don't worry, I'll just drink zupu. My folks, they are good. They made one special zupu. So we said, we'll drink that zupu. Do you understand? But they don't know why. It may look like brothers is arrogant. No, I ate rotten food for 10 years. Brother, God has brought us to the place of abundance. Don't give me rotten food. I ate it for 10 years. And the folks bringing it have never eaten rotten food for that long. So the rice is just so. Those kind of rice, we used to wash them. We carry water, wash it, put it again, put some Maggi. Eat. Before, not me now.
Not me now.
Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
It's not good to be poor. Because if you are poor, God will give you out as a test, as a specimen for Satan to use. God knows what to keep the devil, knows what to do to keep the devil busy. He will look for poor Christians. It's not good to be poor.
May you never be poor in your life.
Amen.
You sound like you are poor.
I'll never be poor in my life.
Lord have mercy upon me.
Lord have mercy.
May I never be poor in my life.
May I never be poor in my life.
So be careful the things you manage. Otherwise God will say, okay, just be faithful and die. So these people, they were going to be faithful to poverty, faithful to tribulation. Yet rapture has not taken place. It's amazing. And the best gift they received from the Lord was just a crown of life. Meanwhile, other churches, they have many things to receive. This one, just a crown. Say, let's crown me in heaven. So could it be when they say, oh, hear the power of Jesus' name, let the angel first fall, bring forth the rose. God and cry him Lord, Lord. Maybe that song is for you.
Lord.
Because Jesus himself suffered to be crowned, right? So say, we must suffer to be crowned. Well, I'm not part of that league.
Not me.
I'm a different kind of Christian.
I'm a different kind of Christian.
In Papa Joshua's generation,
yes, sir.
The king's generation,
yes,
we are
sir.
Not poor.
It's my year of majesty.
See, it may look like you are, but you are not.
I'm not.
Okay. Now, how did we even get here? Okay, go back. Moses was raised in the palace.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that.
Yes,
sir. You see why God could use him? But the people who were carrying bricks, the children of Israel, who were in the heat of the suffering, God did not pick any of them.
Yeah.
God doesn't even like poor people. It was the same poor people that were killed in Revelation chapter 6. There was no mansion for them. They were under the altar. They were crying from under the altar, Revelation chapter 6. Along, long, revenge. God said, wait, shut up. Give them clothes to wear. They didn't even have clothes. They entered heaven without clothes.
Wow.
That's what they're reading. It's there, Revelation chapter 6. They entered heaven without clothes. Then the Lord said, give them clothes to wear.
Wow.
Let them wait that the next pack of their kind are killed. God is waiting for certain people to be killed. Make a decision not to be poor.
I will never be poor in my life.
Listen, the Lord was not speaking slang. That's why we didn't say, I will never be broke. That's slang. No, poor. I will never be poor.
I will never be poor in my life.
Jesus didn't say he came to preach the gospel to the broke. He said he came to preach the gospel to the poor. Okay, now, Exodus chapter 3. I want to show you something quickly. In a few minutes, then we'll dismiss. La Sabarito Shetia. Because if you say you are serving the one and the true God, does he look true in your life? What are the evidences that God is true in your life to show to others that you are serving a true God? You see, you are serving the one and true God. How do we know that the God you are serving is the one and true God? What are the evidences to show that the God you are serving is the one and true God? What are the evidences? Because even right now, when you look at the resume of your life, does it in any way suggest that you are serving the one and true God? Now, let's show you something. Exodus chapter 3. Verses 1. He said, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. Now, read this too. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire. Now, pause. When he says here, the angel of the Lord, literally, it will suggest he's talking about one angel. Meanwhile, the Greek word, the Hebrew word is Molak. Molak. M-A-L-A-K. Molak. Molak means an envoy. What does an envoy suggest?
Company
of angels. So it wasn't one angel. It was a company of angels. But that company of angels were the angels that appeared as fire on the bushes. Now, there's something you need to pay attention to. If you read Psalm 104, verses 4, it says, he maketh his angels spirits, but his ministers a flaming fire. His angels are spirits, but his ministers are a flame of fire.
Yes, sir.
You see that?
Yes.
Now, what did Moses see? Flame of fire.
Yes.
Not consuming the bushes. So, you see, fire. Is fire one? Do you see fire as singular or it is uncountable?
It's uncountable.
It's uncountable just like water. Which means it is in what? Plurality. So that means, really, it was a bush, quite all right, but everywhere Moses looked at, he saw fire. But this fire are ministers.
Wow.
Are ministers. Sitting on bushes. Not consuming it, but sitting on it.
Wow.
My. So they were probably holding a spiritual conference, and Moses walked in.
Wow. Seniors meeting.
Seniors meeting. In a place called waste, Horeb. Horeb means waste, a desolate place. So that means that was the hall they rented.
Hi.
Hey, yeah. Now, it says an envoy. Moses saw them. Moses saw them. Then the protocol officer in that conference of spirits, ministers, saw that Moses was about to interrupt their meeting. Said, he called him, said, Moses, Moses, stop there. Where you have just entered is holy. So that means where ministers gather,
yes, sir,
as a flame of fire, that ground is holy. Now, I'm a minister of God. I don't know about you.
I'm a minister of God.
So that means
wherever I go,
is holy.
Is holy.
And when we meet other ministers,
yes, sir,
and we're together,
yes,
where we are becomes what? A holy ground.
Yes, sir.
See?
Yes, sir.
Now, look up. Notice what the speaker who was talking on behalf of the elders said to Moses in verses 6. Read the first line. He says what? Come on now, let's read. Okay, read from verses 5 into verses 6. Come on. Amen. 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 Please. Are you following what we're doing? Are you following what we're showing?
Yes, sir.
Now, this is not night vigil.
No, no, sir.
Now, why are your faces looking like? Yet you put makeup. If you know how you look with makeup on sleepy eyes.
Oh. Heavy.
If you know how you look with makeup on a sleepy eye. You will know that there would have been no need for the makeup. Because if you put makeup with the intention of just coming to just sleep, you will just not fail. Even to your own face. Because you are not seeing it, we are seeing it. If you know, so for the sake of the makeup on your face, just stay away for a few minutes. So when they tell you now, don't wear makeup now, someone say, how can they say I shouldn't wear makeup? The makeup, you are not even helping it. You are even frustrating the grace of your makeup. Have you ever seen somebody with lipstick? They're like, sleeping, you know, and slime is coming out. All the lipstick. Sorry. Hallelujah.
Oh, man.
There was all this slime on the lipstick. You did like this. Oh. So you rubbed it in and you say hallelujah.
Oh.
You look at it. As his sister.
Lord have mercy.
Are you okay?
Be pure.
Then you look at another sister that is not wearing makeup, paying attention. You say, I don't know why she's not wearing makeup. You that is even wearing, what are you doing with it? You are punishing the makeup.
Wow. Holy Spirit.
And you know, things have intelligence. You see, no matter how she puts the pink powder, red, let's not look good on her. She will use us to sleep. Okay, now. Read verses 5 into verses 6. There's something I want to quickly show you. And he said, do not draw near this place. Because he was going to interrupt their meeting. Okay. Take off your sandals. Okay. From where thou standest is holy ground. Now, there was no record that he removed his shoes. Why? Because what came next would not even permit Moses to bow down and remove his shoes. So, let's read it again from verses 5 into verses 6. You understand what we're trying to say? Do not draw near this place. So he stopped. Okay, read on. Put off your sandals from where you are standing in holy ground. So Moses did not know he has entered a holy ground. Now, if he has already entered, why are you telling him to take off the sandals? He has already entered. Because the reason why you are telling him to take off the sandals is because he is in a holy place. Well, he has already entered that place with his sandals. Why are you trying to tell him to take it off?
True.
Now, as the guy was about to, imagine this, as he was about to even lean to remove the sandals, Moses is writing this. He is not surprised to hear the next thing. So I believe he did not touch his shoes anymore. He preferred to stay. Read the next line. He said, I'm the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Oh, really? If you are the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, did you ever tell them to remove their sandals?
No.
Were they more righteous than Moses? So was it because Moses was a murderer? Jacob stole somebody's destiny for 20 years.
Wow.
Who murders more? Jacob was a crony killer.
Yeah.
Even an angel was telling him, let me go.
That's right.
Just leave me. Your matter, even for us, is about to be daybreak. Let me go. It's about to be done. Now, here's the point. The speaker here is telling Moses, we are the God of your father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Okay, now, I want to show you something. And we're glad that was mentioned. Let's start with Jacob. Then before we enter Isaac, before we enter Abraham. Because that will make us appreciate who the God of Abraham is. That is the same God of Isaac that is now the God of Jacob. If we can understand how he related with Jacob and where that God came from, then we'll be able to know which God the children of Israel we're serving, whether that God looks like the God you and I are serving. And if he's the same person, why are you still relating with him as the way he related with others we read about? So, go to Genesis 28. When Jacob had taken his brother's blessing, Esau, his father advised him, run away and go to your uncle's house and go and be with your who? Go and meet your mother's brother, Laban, right?
Yes, sir.
And marry one of his daughters, mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
They have good women.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, those women, they do voodoo.
Yeah.
Marry voodoo woman. Say, it is good for you. Wow. For 419 people like you, you deserve voodoo people. Yet he was carrying a blessing. He was not advised to go and marry a daughter of a native doctor, a daughter of a voodoo priest. Wow. Because Nabal was more or less like a voodoo priest. He had his own altar. He knew how to throw his own oracles. Okay, now. Genesis chapter what? 28. Okay. La soroko shipati la kushetea. Soto te te te. Remember when Jacob ran, he had a dream, right?
Yes, sir.
He got to a certain place. Let's read. Let's read from verses 10 of Genesis chapter 28. Please, we would like to beg of you. Read with us.
Yes, sir.
So that you can see something we want to show you.
Yes, sir.
And please, if your makeup is the reason why you are not seeing clearly because of your eyelash, just remove it so that we can read this thing. If your eyelashes are the reason why you are not seeing clearly, or the claws you have on your hands is why you don't know how to flip, you're nothing like this. Dear God, there's, you know, we wonder the ways whether some ladies know how to hold spoon with the kind of claws they carry. How do they open the door? From verses 10. Let's read. Now Jacob went out from Beersheba and went towards Haran. So he came to a certain place. Now, Haran was the place God called Abraham.
Yeah.
And Haran was the place where Haran, who happens to be Lot's father, died. And that was also the same place Abraham's father, Terah, died to. Okay, so it was a place where family members had died. Okay, now, let's read them. So he came to a certain place and stayed there all night because the sun had set. And he took one of the stones of that place and put it at his head, and he lay down in that place to sleep. Read verse 12 now. Then he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached the heaven. So the ladder did not come from heaven. The ladder was from the earth to heaven. That's the difference. Because when Peter had his own dream, a sheet came from heaven. This one, we're told, it was from the earth to heaven. Okay, read on now. And come on now, let's read now. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending. Now, how many angels? Sing one angel or many angels?
Many angels.
Many angels. Follow this carefully now. Because the one who introduced himself to Moses said, I am the God of your father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And that word God is the word Elohim, which means plural. So these angels that were ascending, and the word Elohim means divine beings, plural. The word Elohim means divine beings, B-E-I-N-G-S, in plural. Now, do you agree angels are divine beings?
Yes.
So these are, in a sense, the Elohim. Where did he meet them? Well, in Haran, right?
Yes.
But you get to know the exact place in Haran because it will play a crucial role in understanding why you have to tell Moses, I'm the God of your father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You get to see. Okay, now, read on. It says what? And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham. Oh, now, remember, he said, I am the God of Abraham. Elohim. Now he says, I'm the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and your descendants. Okay. Now, because of time, let us speed fast forward and come to verses 17. Let's start from verse 16. Read. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. Verse 17. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. Okay. He calls it what? The house of God. Mark that. Okay. Read on now. And the gates of heaven. The house of God and the gates of heaven. Mark those expressions. Okay. Now verse 18. Then Jacob. Come on, read now. Then Jacob rose early in the morning and took the stone that he has put at his head and set it up as a pillar and poured oil on top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel.
Wow.
Mark it. Bethel. Bethel.
Bethel.
Okay, read on. The name of that city was previously called what? Luz. But now Jacob called it what? Bethel. Now notice, Jacob called it Bethel. When you now go to Genesis chapter 13, when God called Abraham, and told him to live in Genesis chapter 12, the Bible says when he got to Bethel, he gave God an offering. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that place was not called Bethel.
That's true.
Because Abraham pre-existed Jacob.
Jacob, yes sir.
Now, we have been told it was Jacob who named it Bethel. The previous name was what? Luz. So that means when Abraham got there in Genesis chapter 13, it was actually what? Luz. Genesis chapter 12 actually. It was Luz, not Bethel. So who named it Bethel? You see, Bible expositors called it Bethel because they had already known what Jacob had called it. Now, follow this carefully. Abraham gave an offering unto the Lord in Bethel many, many years back. But did God accept of that offering? Now, we are being told now, listen carefully.
Yes, sir.
Listen carefully.
Yes, sir.
We are being told now that Bethel is in a place called Haran.
Yeah.
That's what you are reading.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yeah.
But Haran was the place God told Abraham to leave.
Yeah. Wow.
Get thee out of your country, out of your kindred, out of your father's house.
Yes, sir.
So they came from the all of the Chaldeans, got to Haran, and he died. Mm-hmm. Terah died. Because Haran died before Terah, his father.
Yeah.
Who happens to be the father of Abraham. Terah died now. Then God now told Abraham, continue. So it was Terah who began the journey. So Abraham only continued his father's journey.
Yes, sir.
But now, in that journey, you would think, because when God met Abraham, going by Genesis chapter 12, verses 1, it would suggest that God spoke to Abraham in Haran, which actually happened. But if you look at it, God had said to Abraham, get thee out of your kindred, Genesis chapter 12. But when God said that to him, we were never told. We were never told. So if you have to go by that narration, then it will only mean that God spoke to Abraham in Haran. Now, I would think that in Haran, when God said to get out, that means he just started going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But now, what we're reading from Jacob's account, what we're reading concerning Jacob's account, we're reading that Jacob got to Haran, where God has spoken to Abraham.
Yeah.
Now, he now came to the place called Bethel. Now, the Bible says Abraham in Genesis chapter 12 left Haran but gave an offering to God in Bethel. Now, the question is Bethel a different place from Haran, or Bethel is a place in Haran?
It's a
Hey, come on now, you look funny now. You understand?
Yes, sir.
So when did he finally leave Haran? So I said, you know, they were trekking now, so they have to go a long way. Now, come to find out. If you read 1 Kings chapter 13, where is Bethel? The Bible says God sent a man of God to Samaria, to the place called Bethel. So Bethel is
it's in Samaria.
Bethel is in Samaria. Yeah. So what is Samaria? Haran.
Wow. Whoa. Wow.
Is a circle.
Wow. Wow. Wow.
So if you think God took only the children of Israel through the wilderness, no, these ones, they were also going in circle. Now, there's a reason why this is very, very important.
Amen.
Read verses 20. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God will be with me and keep me in this way that I'm going, and give me bread to eat and clothing to put on, so that I come back to my father's house in peace. Where is his father's house in peace? No.
Better.
No. See, that's the point. Come on. No. Samaria is Haran now.
Yes.
So what was his father's house? They were in Gerar. Come on now.
Yeah.
Genesis chapter 26.
Yes.
Isaac lived in Gerar.
Yeah.
Come on now. He lived in Gerar. In Canaan.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Do you understand?
Yes.
It was between the borders of the Philistines and Canaan.
Yeah.
Then he now told them, he now told Jacob, don't marry the Canaanites. So that don't marry the Canaanite women. So that means that they were all around.
Yeah.
Did you understand?
Yeah.
Now this is very, very important. This is very, very important. Okay. He says, if God will bring me back to my house. But the God that spoke to him, did he speak to him from his house?
No.
Now he said, if God will take me back to my house. So the question is, which God was he talking to? Well, he was certainly talking to the God who met him in where? In Bethel.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes, sir.
But we know his house, 20 years later, is where? Gerar.
Yeah.
Close to Canaan. Yeah, Canaan actually. Gerar in Canaan. It's an angle. Did you understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You see, like, the reason why we're telling you this is that where you first met God, that is the God you still serve.
Wow.
So it matters which God you met and where you met him. So when you are saying you are calling on the God of Papa Joshua Egila, Papa Joshua Egila knew where he met God, who is with him today, that is exalting him. And he and he alone can show you who that God is. And how does he do it? By trying to teach you how that God operates with him as a person.
Yeah.
Yes,
see. Read on. It says, and this stone
which I have set as a pillar.
Read verse 21 again. So that I come back to my father's house in peace, then the Lord shall be my God. Now notice. Notice. He is claiming. Look up, please. He is claiming a strange God. Someone said, how can you call him a strange God? When he already said, I'm the God of your father, Abraham, and Isaac. He didn't know him. And he didn't meet that God in his father's house. He met the God in Bethel, a place where Abraham was told to live, where Terah was buried. Now, you see, he is now acknowledging, well, this one that I spoke, this one that spoke to me in my sleep, he who will now be my God. So he acknowledged it.
Yes.
That this one will be my God. Now, this is very, very important. Very, very important. Don't miss this. Okay. Now, and this stone which I have set as a pillar shall be God's house. Now, you see that? He called the stone God's house. So you see why now Bethel became a place where worship was being done. Please give us your attention.
Yes, sir.
Now, and all of you, or in all that you give me, I will surely give a tithe to you. Now, go to chapter 31. Chapter 31, I want to show you something. Now, this, remember in chapter 28 we just read,
yes.
It was still better, Haran, right?
Yes.
He still had a long journey to go to Syria. Syria.
Yeah.
That's another country.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, read from verses 11 of chapter 31. Can we read? One, two, go. Then the angel of God spoke to me in a dream, saying,
Jacob.
And he said, here am I. Read verses 12 now. And he said, lift up your eyes now and see all the rams which live on the flocks as stakes and sparkle and gray spotted. For I have seen all that Laban is doing. Read verses 13 now. I am the God of Bethel. See that? Wait. I am the God of Bethel. The God Jacob pledged his loyalty to was the God of his fathers Abraham and Isaac. So who is this one saying I'm the God of Bethel? What are you doing in Syria? We're in another country.
True.
You should be the God of the people in Bethel. I'm not in Bethel. He says, Jacob, I'm the God of Bethel. He's telling Jacob, I'm the God of Bethel. That means, Jacob, you can't say you don't know me. I'm the one you met in Bethel. Now, notice that. What did Jacob call Bethel? The house of God and the gate of heaven. God says, I'm the God of Bethel. I'm the God of Bethel. So that means it matters where you once encountered God.
Yes.
And no matter where you go under heaven, that God you met, even though you met him in a village, when he comes away, he will always introduce himself as the God you met in the village. When last did you call him by that? That becomes a question. Because you met him in Connecticut. Now you are calling on the I am, the ocean divider. And he's saying,
What are you saying?
God, speak to me. Speak to me. God says, now, I'm the God of Connecticut. Somebody say, I rebuke you by fire. The God I serve is the God of all the universe. He says, I'm the God of Bethel. Read on, you see something. I'm the God of Bethel, where you are anointed the pillar. And where you made a vow to me. So, when he says he's the God of Bethel, he's actually saying, I'm the God of your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that met you in Bethel. And I'm the God of Bethel. So you see, when Jacob acknowledged where he encountered God, that God became the God of that place. And if that God is going to come, now notice. See, our most highly esteemed Papa Joshua Aguila comes here. Of course, this is his church.
Yes, sir.
See, brother is only his pastor here. See, but this is his church. So, you met The angel of God in the person of Papa Joshua Egill here in Mount Moriah.
Yes.
Champions Royal Assembly, Mount Moriah. You met the God of Papa Joshua Egill here in Champions Royal Assembly, Mount Moriah, New Jersey. Fine. You met him. Right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, how come when you are praying now, you say, I call on the God of Papa Joshua Egill. Someone say, is it the same? No. If that God wants to talk to you, he will say, I'm the God of Mount Moriah, where you met Papa Joshua Egill. That's how he introduced himself.
Yes, sir.
He's showing us a pattern.
Wow.
You see why people who break out, like assistant pastors, who break out to go and start their churches, they don't know what they are doing. They don't know what they are doing. You don't know what they are doing. Because wherever you run to go and open your own church, if you are saying, I call on the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, even God will ask you, who is he? Did you ever meet the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, or you met the God of that pastor that you broke out from to go and start your own church? So who will answer your prayers? If you break out to go and start your own church, which God will even answer any prayer you pray over your members? The God of the pastor you broke out from. You see why it's foolish to just say, you want to rebel to go and start your own church. It's foolish.
Yes, sir.
Because no matter where you go to, no matter the success, even if you are backing stadiums, people are gathering. The God that is still working those miracles are the God you met in the place of that man of God. Because if that God did not show up there, you will not know him.
True.
You see why it matters who leads your life, who your father is. God came. He said, I'm the God of your father. Mm-hmm. The next time you meet Jacob, 20 years later, he said, I'm the God of Bethel. It isn't the God of your father anymore. Till Jacob died, he never referred to him as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, I want to show you one final thing. Now, the word angel is the word Molak again. That's what we brought you here. The same envoy. They said, we run better. Now, I want to show you quickly something. Go to, I think, Genesis 35. If I go to chapter 32 first. Chapter 32. Read verses 1. So Jacob, come on now, verse 13, verse 1. So Jacob went on his way, and Molad of God met him. When Jacob saw them, he called, he said, this is God's camp. And he called the name of the place Mahanaim. Now, Mahanaim is not Bethel. So Bethel is God's house, Mahanaim is God's camp.
Wow.
And who was he meeting? The same group of angels. You see, Molak. So Jacob did not know one God. He knew a group of angels.
Yes, envoy.
The envoy. Now, follow this carefully. This is in another place now. He walked into them. What are they doing here?
Wow.
Now, these were the same group now. Moses now met in another place.
Oh.
This is another group now. Moses now met in another place. In Horeb.
Yeah.
So you see, they move. That is why, like our papa now, if he calls for a meeting and say, we're going to meet, like now, we're having a program in Atlanta. And he says, now, let's meet in Atlanta. You can't say, well, I can't go to Atlanta. Well, I'll just stay here in New Jersey. Mm-hmm. I'll just serve God. I'll watch it on TV. Mm-hmm. And you think, so say, the same God there in Atlanta, where Papa Joshua is holding the program, is touching me too by fire. It's the same anointing. It's not the same because the angels have moved to Atlanta.
Yes, sir. Wow.
Yes, sir.
So at that material time, that is The God you are now serving is the God of Atlanta, not the God of New Jersey. Because the one you met in New Jersey has moved to Atlanta.
Yes, sir.
You see why Elisha was smart? He said, as long as the Lord liveth, I will never leave you. Because Elisha knew by experience, by the character of Elijah, that God moves from one place to another.
Yes, sir. Wow.
So how can you call for a crusade? You know, and the foolish things some junior pastors do.
Yes, sir.
Some assistant pastors is to organize a crusade without letting the senior pastor know.
Wow.
And expect that there's going to be a mighty move. You are fasting, Jack. One word from the father himself, he said that program is blessed. That's all that is required. It covers your many days of fasting.
Yes, sir. True.
So you organize a crusade without letting the superior know. Which God answered the prayers? So the miracles took place. No, it was their faith that brought the miracle. The God of your father was not there. The God of your father was not there. Now, look at chapter 35. Look at, notice the expression now. Read verses 1. 1 to go.
Then God
said to Jacob. Now, the word God is the word Elohim too. Okay, now read. Then God said to Jacob. Come on, let's read. Then God said to Jacob, arise, go to Bethel and dwell there. He said, go and live in Bethel.
Wow.
He said, go and live in Bethel.
Yes, sir.
What was better? Better is what is known today as Samaria. Because when Jesus met the woman by the well, she said, our father Jacob built this well.
Yes.
So, for instance, if you are from Nigeria, for instance, you met Papa Joshua Egila in New Jersey. Now, even though you are from Nigeria, you live in America, New Jersey, America, but you have a house in Anambra State, that's not where you should live. If you say you are following the God of Papa Joshua Egila, no, it is where Papa Joshua Egila is. That's where you should live.
Yes, sir.
So, you say you travel to Nigeria to go and visit your family. How long did you stay in Nigeria? Well, I just spent 2 weeks in Nigeria. Where did you go to? I went to Port Harcourt. I went to Enugu. I went to Lagos. I went to Calabar. I went to Tanzania. Did you even go to Abuja at all? Oh no, you know, I have some other things to take care of. But the God of Papa Joshua Egila is protecting me. No, the God of Papa Joshua Egila did not protect you. Because the God of Papa Joshua Egila did not even know you were in town.
Wow.
Because the God of Papa Joshua Egila is where the man of God himself is. And if you say you are under his grace, how come he did not know you were in town? How come he did not know? It's like somebody now, like now, as it is right now, even though by grace, God made me a senior by grace, under this grace. I can't go to Atlanta now and say I'm going to Atlanta City. Eh?
Yeah.
No, there's a city called Atlanta. Right?
Yeah.
Atlantic. Okay, Atlantic. I can't say I'm going to Atlantic. So I fly to Atlantic. Without ever letting Sister Nadine know that I'm in Atlanta. So I would just call her. Call? Call. No, even before I go to Atlantic, the first place I should go to is Gwinnett, right? That's where Sister Nadine lives. So I need to show Sister Nadine that I'm around before I start going to Atlantic. But what people do is they go to the Atlantic first and run their business and do everything. Then sometimes, and usually some people, they always get to a brick wall. They say, yes, Sister Nadine, say, let me call her. She can even help me out. Then Sister Nadine is surprised to know you were in town. How loyal were you? What a champion member you are. Then tomorrow you say, I call on the God of champions. The Lord said, this unfaithful person. I don't even know this person. This one that dishonored even the pastor of Atlanta. I did not dishonor, I don't owe anything. But I told her I was coming to Atlanta, but did you go to see her? Okay, let's suppose you were caught up in what you were doing. And what you came to Atlanta to do was very urgent. Did you still make her time to still go and see her? Sometimes I will just call her on the phone. What you don't know is that even the phone now, the phone call has made you a backslider.
Wow.
Because even in the fraternity, they don't do that way.
That's true.
A member of a fraternity is in town. The first place he goes to is the fraternity house.
Yeah.
I was in a fraternity before I gave my heart to Christ. We don't do that. No matter how, even if it's a court case that I have, I must go to the fraternity head of that place to let them know I'm in town. Sometimes they can even call the judge and say, dismiss that case. Sit down, let's eat. Don't dismiss the matter. But I came to town for a court case. Do you know one word from Sister Nadine to you in Atlanta can settle everything?
Amen. Yeah.
So the thing is that if you are saying you are serving the God of champions, how effective have you been in champions? In fact, even the leadership, how do you relate with them? How do you operate? Because it looks so trivial, so ordinary. It's like somebody who comes. Recall, our papa had a program here, and a brother came. And he came for the program, said he was coming from Florida, and said he would let, of course, he queued up to see Papa, he met Papa, and Papa could recognize him. I almost esteemed Papa Joshua Aguilar could recognize him. Because he said, how are you? So what are you doing here? He said, I'm here in America, and I live in America, and all that. So after he greeted Papa, Papa prayed for him, he left. So he came to me and took my phone number and gave me his phone number and said that he would like to do some things for Champions Real Assembly here in America, and that he used to work in the headquarters, he was a staff. So I said, no problem. It so happened that I was privileged to be with our most esteemed Papa Joshua Aguilar, and a conversation came up so I mentioned that guy. I was amazed what Papa said. I said, sir, he said he knows. He said, yeah, I know him. I said, so he wants to assist the ministry with this and other. I was surprised. Papa and I said, do you know him? I said, no, I'm just meeting him for the first time. He said, so how can you trust him with an assignment? Someone you don't really know. Is it because I know him? I don't live here. You live here. Whatever goes wrong, I'll hold you responsible here. See that? Say, do you know him? Did he ever come to you? I asked him how long he's been in America. He told me how long, and he never came here.
Wow.
Now he showed up because I'm having a program. Now, all of a sudden, he wants to assist the ministry. And that was the last time we saw the guy. Even in New York, the guy lives in New York, did not come for the New York program. Now imagine if we have committed something to him to handle on behalf of Champions America. It would be a flop.
Yeah.
And who would the man of God query?
You.
But
there
was, yeah. Imagine if I said, but sir, he knows you. He's a staff. He used to work in the headquarters. This is, that would be the peak of irresponsibility. Mm-hmm. See, you need to understand the way God behaves through the way your superior behaves. Do you know who controls the territory? That you have a Champions Royal Assembly Church in any city means that the gate of that city is supposed to open to you by favor.
Amen. Yes, sir.
By the grace of the man of God. Yes, now you enter that city without even going to see the principality there.
That's right.
Wow.
Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
The one that the God of Champions is backing in that city, you didn't even go to pay homage to that person. Or it's like you now going to South Africa, or you go to Rambog. So you are in South Africa, and you could not even go to, someone said, you could not go to any of the Champions tour. Someone said, I'll go there on Sunday. But when did you arrive in South Africa? I arrived in South Africa on Wednesday. And Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It took you 4 days to go and connect to the pastor. And the pastor doesn't know. Then let's suppose a building collapsed, the hotel you lost collapsed, and you died, or you were in distress. You now start making phone calls. I'm a member of Champions Royal Assembly. And the pastor is wondering, I don't know this one. Then tomorrow you see it on the papers. A member of Champions Royal Assembly died. Maybe the man of God used him for rituals. See? Then you begin to malign the name of the ministry. Then you expect the man of God to now come and start explaining, re-explaining. He doesn't owe you that. And when you see the, was it not today we were together? A brother who walked out on us in this ministry 3 years ago called us on the phone today. We were Pastor Buki. I mean, there was nothing he didn't say. Even went around town, said all manner of nonsense. Today he was, you know the person. You know the person. This was somebody, through the grace of this ministry, he got 10 years green card.
Wow.
By the word of the Lord, we told him they are going to give you 10 years.
Hmm.
And we told him what they will ask him in the interview. We said they will ask you this question. That was exactly what they asked him. But at the end of the day, he walked out, man, 3 years ago, it was a big shipwreck.
Hmm.
He called us on the phone today and said, please, I have come to see my phone.
Amen.
He said, please, I'm so sorry. He said, I got to know that's not how to behave in ministry. I said, I'm glad you discovered it. He said, oh, I'm so sorry. So that it do not look that, because if I ended the call, I'm not saying Sister Pastor Buki would doubt me, but the truth of the matter is, what did Pastor Buki do? And interestingly, we got to know him through Pastor Buki. And it's how God arranged it now.
Yeah.
Pastor Buki was the person who brought the guy into the ministry. That was some years back. Now, Pastor Buki was there, so we put him on speaker. I said, Pastor Buki is here. He was even surprised.
Mm.
See? But now he had to go and travel around, learn the hard way before he could acknowledge that he did not do it right. Why do you have to suffer before you learn?
Thank you.
Yeah. Now, Brother Ozzy, if you were to build a house in Nigeria, where would you build a house? Abuja.
Abuja.
Exactly. Why? Why don't you build a house in my village? I have no business there. The God that I'm serving is in Kubo. You see why some people will go and build a house in the village. Witchcraft will attack it. Somebody will use witchcraft to attack it. Now they are calling on the God that they refuse to acknowledge to help them from the witchcraft of the village. And the God of Abuja is saying, I don't have access to your village. Because I didn't even know you were going to even build a house. Now, see what the Lord said. He said, go and live in Bethel. That means don't go back to your father's house where Isaac lived. But the blessing he got from Isaac. Where Isaac lived, Abraham had been there. He said, don't live there. That means that the era of and the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had already ended. Now, Jacob knew God as the God of Bethel. Now, the same God now is not coming to Moses. He used the same pattern again. I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Later on in Exodus, you discover when he was going to talk, when Moses came and said, Lord, they will not answer me. He said, Moses, your father Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob knew me as El Shaddai, but I'm not like that. Now I'm Jehovah. From that day, they all started calling him Jehovah. Jehovah. Actually, Jehovah was not the name really. It was Yahweh. Jehovah was a word initiated by a Greek scholar, a Bible scholar called Galactinus in 1520. Jehovah was, Moses never knew the word Jehovah. Moses will be surprised if you call Jehovah. It was a guy that brought them that word Jehovah or Yehovah by the name of Galactinus in 1520. So it was not in the original manuscript Jehovah. It was the word Yahweh. He said, I'm Yahweh, I'm not Jehovah. So when you see Jehovah, man of war, that God fought war, another quiet war. They are not fighting over kingdoms. God was not trying to take Egypt from Pharaoh. He was just trying to say, Pharaoh, let my people go. Period. Take your kingdom. So did God fight war against the children of Israel? There was no war. No
true.
War.
True.
Which war? What would mean he took over the kingdom? Well, he didn't. Even when the Pharaoh died, he was not interested in the kingdom.
Hmm.
Why? Because the Lord knows we are coming.
Yes, sir.
I'm telling you, he said the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ.
Yes, sir.
The kingdom is mine.
The kingdom is mine.
You see why I have the whole world and I still follow Jesus?
I have the whole world and I still follow Jesus.
It sounds like you mean it.
I have the whole world and I still follow Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I have the whole world. So which world. God do you know?
The God of Mount Moriah.
Yes, sir. And the God of Moriah is the same God of Baba Joshua Egila.
Yes, sir.
So why do you say the God of Moriah? Because you met the God of Baba Joshua Egila where?
In Mount Moriah.
And in Mount Moriah, where Baba Joshua Egila came and ministered, the supernatural took place. And yes. That Lord there, the Almighty there, marked you.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
And in case Jacob was going to say, I don't, that name does not ring a bell. He said, I'm the God of Bethel where you made a vow.
Yeah. Wow.
He told him, gave him details. Don't say you don't know me.
Wow.
Don't say you don't know me.
Yes, sir.
Don't even say you don't know me. Don't try it.
I will never try it.
So God himself, he will force his introduction to you.
Isn't
it amazing? You are trying to have a picture of Jerusalem. God is giving you the picture of New Jersey. God said, Jerusalem, this is where we met. So I said, no, they baptized me with the same water of John the Baptist. So I said, but I met Papa Joshua for the first time in Jerusalem. So that means I'm serving the God of Jerusalem. Okay. That's how you want to put it. How did Paul know Jesus? He knew Jesus as well. Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
True.
Because that's how Jesus introduced himself.
That's
and
true.
There was no time Paul ever narrated his encounter without making reference of his experience on his way to Damascus. Each time he stood before the ruler, he would make reference to his experience with Damascus. And each time he spoke, the people he was talking to were convinced. It was easy because his God, he had already welcomed. That's how to welcome the presence of your God.
Wow.
By acknowledging where you encountered him.
Wow.
Except you don't believe in that person's God. So now you went to one crusade. You say you encounter God. Okay. You went to Milano or Malina in Philippines. You encounter God. Then you went to Kinshasa.
Wow.
You say you encounter God. Okay, you did. Then you came to South Africa, Rambo. You encounter God.
Yeah.
Okay. So which God do you know? Well, I call on the God of Kinshasa. No, God will not say he's the God of Kinshasa. He will say the God of Malina. Even though you met him at other places, he will always take you back to Malina. Where you know you really had that encounter. Where you know your calling was confirmed. Where you know you made a vow to God. So say, that means, brother, I don't belong here. All right, go then.
I belong here.
But I'm a success forevermore.
I'm a success forevermore.
I'm a success forevermore.
I'm a success forevermore.
I don't know whether you believe me, but I am a success forevermore.
I'm a success forevermore.
It's time to pray.
Yes, sir.
I don't know which God you want to call on. Yes, sir. Where the God of Papa Joshua Egila met, where I met the God of Papa Joshua Egila. One time he said, I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, which was the God of individuals? Now he's saying, I'm the God of a place.
Yes.
The place where you made that vow. Pasatali sobre tequila cruscap. Rende kescopretes. Rusiti palataya. Leko porodo mekiski pratus. Pasatapale tequila cruscamate. Pray, amen. Have you ever encountered God before? Well, it doesn't sound like you have. Where? So talk to the Lord now. If you believe you have encountered God here, then talk to that God. If you encountered the God of Champions Royal Assembly, well, this is Champions Royal Assembly. Talk to him. La Paparos. Le Poporodos. Sapa Sataya. Polo Sekete. Polo Sakapale. Ritu Male. Sobre Denevaria Tuske. Le Sekaparatu Bokosete. Tell him what you want him to do for you. The God of Champions. Tell him.
Jesus' name.
He's here. Sakapale. That you are a member here in this ministry meant that you encountered God in a different way. Here in Champions Royal Assembly. So talk to the Lord. Le prasura katia, la parade, le poko shakapale, rusutuya, makapale, sorede kopetia, kisapa, le te prosete, pali kaparade, suta pales, rekoporo doke pesiti, suta para kaparusa kata, rate kopo shakapatia. Talk to the Lord. Le kaparade. Tell him what you want him to fix for you. Le prosete. Lord, touch me again. Le prosete prosa kapalete. Siki tiki shakata. Male kaprosete. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
So, which means, if at all you even plan to relocate, you should not live far from where you encounter God, where they have a branch. Like now, if you met God in Champions Royal Assembly, you should not live far from, if you are relocating somewhere, you should not go to a place where there is no Champions Royal Assembly.
Yes,
right. Some say, I can just worship in any church. Right. It's not done that way. There's an order. That's what we're showing you. There's an order. And if you know you are someone not equipped or authorized by the Spirit to even start a Champions Fellowship or outreach, and you know by the Spirit now, you know by the Spirit that there's no Champions Royal Assembly and you have not been authorized to start one, then it means that that's not a place to live. Because no matter the prayer you pray, the God of Champions that used to answer your prayer is not there. It's not there. That's the reason why many destinies today are broken. A lot of Christians. A lot of Christians. Someone says, my job, I move from one place to the other. Okay. You move from one place to the other. You see why you should, where you live should not be a deterrent from coming to meet the God that you encounter.
Yeah.
Someone said, well, I can still stay in my house and watch like I'm watching on TV and then I'll still be blessed. You know, the people we have heard talk that way. Even in this ministry, even in Champions Royal Assembly, like in New York, we have met some folks who say, well, I can still watch. And when you ask them, why don't you go to the church in Champions and the branch in New York? Well, you know, from where I live is far from where the branch is. Really? One man said to me, brother, see, but in case God is showing you anything, I want you to tell me what God wants me to tell you. I said, I'll tell you. God wants you to serve. Go serve in church. He said, but you know my work and this and that. I also go to this other church. So I just like Papa. I like Baba. But I believe in his prophetic ministry. How can it work for you when your loyalty is divided? That's the condition many are in. So I have to tell you, I said, sir, with all due respect, he's an elderly person. I said, with all due respect, look at me. Am I not progressing? I said, don't you think we're making the right decision? He said, I know. I said, and you're an elderly person, a grandfather. And it doesn't look like you're making the right decision at all. You say you like the man of God. You don't want to be part of his work. So I said, but I attend, he actually said, I attend his crusades. I said, so where are the victories? Why are you still asking me anything God has shown me I should reveal to you? He said, can't you see that whatever grace we are functioning with is the same grace from the man of God? So I said, sir, put your priorities right. If a grandfather can be behaving like this, I wonder what becomes of your own children.
Wow.
He said, brother, it's true, really. Meanwhile, where the church is in New York, he used to worship in a church there many years, and he was faithful. So he actually was very upset that I did not give him prophecy. He was very upset. I said, I should give him prophecy. I said, I'm giving him prophecy. He said,
yes, sir.
He said, but brother, you pray for these people. God shows you things concerning them. I said, what God showed me is what I've told you. Said. It's not hard. See, that kind of person, which God will he pray to? He will call on the God of this other church, then call on this the God of champions. How can he work for you? Many are like that. You see why God said my children are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. But he says, through knowledge shall the just be delivered. Deliverance has come to you now.
Amen.
Say, I'm not a dissident in the house of God.
I'm not a dissident in the house of God.
I'm not a derelict in the house of God.
I'm not a derelict in the house of God.
I'm not a rebel in the house of God.
I'm not a rebel in the house of God.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I'm not a fool in the house of God.
I'm not a fool in the house of God.
I'm not a vagabond in the house of God.
I'm not a vagabond in the house of God.
Notice, no matter what you say to Jacob, Jacob will tell you, Bethel is where God lives.
Yes,
sir. He said, Bethel is the house of God.
Mount Moriah is the house of God.
He said, better is God's house.
Mount Moriah is God's house.
Better, he said.
Yes, sir.
So, how about Haran? Where you receive the blessing, he said, God does not live there. It is Esau that lives there. God does not live there. He said, better is the house of God. Never be ashamed to brag about the God you believe. That's why you see, because you don't know this thing, that's why you are not always fully persuaded to insist that your friend must follow you to church. So,
wow.
Come, follow me. I can tell you what my God can do for you.
Yes.
Follow me to God's house.
This is
I'll bring you to God's house. So, say, I can worship anywhere. There's a church next door. When you need a job, do you go to a job next door?
No.
You don't go to a job next door.
No, sir.
But church, you say you worship in a church next door. Meanwhile, you knew the God. You know the man of God you call all the time for prayer.
Wow.
And he's not next door.
True.
He's not the pastor of the church next door.
True.
Don't be like that, right? Say, I'm an obedient child of God.
I'm an obedient child of God.
I'm an obedient champion.
I'm an obedient champion.
Under the grace of our Father.
Under the grace of our Father.
Papa Joshua Aguila.
Papa Joshua Aguila.
And our mama.
And our mama.
Mama MC Joshua Aguila.
Mama MC Joshua Aguila.
Yes, walk in the light of it. See, our Papa is very majestic in his life.
Yes, sir.
It should reflect in your life.
Amen.
The God, he says, see, the God, when our Papa comes and tells us each year what the Lord said the year will be for us, that's the side God is showing us he will be for the year.
Wow.
So that means that our Papa has said to us, this year is the year of majesty.
Amen.
Which means that our God will never show himself as a poor God.
Yes, sir.
You understand?
Yes,
he will never show himself as a God that is destitute.
Yes.
He will always show himself as a God that is majestic.
Yes, sir.
Now, question. Has your life been majestic so far? If not, it means that you are not doing what you ought to do in the house of God. Because the God we are serving. See, you can't say you believe in the God of champions. And the God of champions has told us, this year I will manifest myself in your life as the majestic God, and your life will be majestic. You can't say you believe in the majestic God of champions and believe in the supernatural God of another ministry.
Wow.
God does not confuse himself.
True, sir.
And we are not saying that the other ministry, they are wrong. That's how God chose to show himself to them. But to us in Champions, this is how God has chosen to show himself to us this year. So let's do it that way.
Yes, sir.
Have you ever seen a human being who can walk well with the two legs wide?
No, sir.
You be walking like they say,
balance.
No one wants to help you. Don't give you space. They will pass. That's how some people are in the spirit.
Wow.
They even have three legs.
Hi.
One leg in one ministry that says, this year is the year of supernatural. This other ministry says, this year is the year of breakthrough. I like this superman of God too. I see him on Instagram. And that one says, this year is the year of financial breakthrough. Hey God, you know, I've not been able to pay my mortgage. Okay, this leg, where will you take it to? That means you will produce another leg. You know what some Christians do? They will put two legs and then they will say, I receive, I collect, I do like this. And that's an octopus.
I'm not an octopus Christian.
I'm not an octopus Christian. Shafa! Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Have you been blessed?
Yes, sir.
Were you blessed by this lesson?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
For some of you, for the first time, you came to terms to say, man, of a truth, I know the God I'm serving now.
I know the God I'm serving
now. So you see,
now
when somebody comes and say, come to my church, you say, no. I'm not saying something is wrong with your church, but I know the God that I've encountered.
I know the God I've encountered.
I know the
God.
Now, Jacob was a grown man. Some people say, I can't leave this church. I was born in this church. I grew up in this church, and I will die in this church. Jacob was a grown man. He did not die in Gerar.
True.
He stayed with the God of Bethel in Bethel. Even when he went to Syria, God said, go back to Bethel, go and live there.
That was his makum.
Exactly, yeah. The word makum. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
All right, it's time to close now, right?
Wow.
Say to somebody, congratulations. Stay where you have encountered God.
Stay where you have encountered God.
Be instructive. Tell the person,
stay where you have encountered God.
Don't let these your legs become octopus legs.
Don't let these your legs become octopus legs.
Don't let your spiritual legs become octopus legs.
Let your spiritual legs become octopus legs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the truth. Don't let your legs. Tell somebody,
These are beautiful spiritual legs.
Say the person, I hope these are your beautiful legs.
I hope these are your beautiful legs.
They are stationed here. Don't be an octopus Christian. One leg in one ministry. Another leg in another ministry.
Then
your head somewhere.
Your hand somewhere.
Don't be like that. You know, take your seat, please. It is like some ladies sometimes. They have a boyfriend in one ministry. They have another one in another ministry. They pay periodic visits. They are now into a serious relationship with the brother in another ministry. Then there's one brother they see from time to time. Whenever they are in town,
wow.
He goes to another ministry. Now, wedding cards. So the guy says, let's get married. And he says, let's take our time. Because
need to break fire as well.
She wants to resign.
Cut off some legs.
She wants to give handover notes.
Yes. Wow.
Some, even on their wedding day,
2 week notice.
They are still telling because the other boyfriend heard they are getting married. Came to see for them, said, see the world, we'll talk about it. You know, we'll talk about it. I'm telling you, it's a long story. The story is always long.
It's true.
That kind of sister said, if you ask her now, where are you going to do the wedding? She'll tell you, no, I just want something quiet. Because if they go to church A, church B will be angry.
Yes.
Even the job you are doing, you got it through our ministry.
Oh.
That's true.
So now, how would they print the wedding card? So they say, you know, let's just do only court. Court is central.
True.
Speaking tongue speaking Christian. Say, let's just do only court. Or they say, let's just do tradition. It's just traditional. Pastor, we're still planning the white wedding. This one is white wedding, sir. White. They call it white wedding.
True, sir. Yeah. What's white about?
But the guy is wearing black jacket. You don't call it black. Okay. So, where are we going to do it? Say, let's go to the fields. You know, so that we can sing them. Let's do it with nature.
Canopy.
Nature. Let's go to a resort. You see the trees, and they'll just put that small tent.
Whoa.
They'll just put chairs.
Yeah.
And usually they always invite a priest. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she goes to a Pentecostal church.
Hi. True.
But the president, do you promise to solemnly swear? That you stick to Susanna for better, for worse, in richer and poorer, in sickness and in health, so help you God. It is so help us. I do. No, usually the guest voice is very light. I do. You say, oh, she's so innocent. And he say, brother, do you promise? And when he talked to the guy, Marcus, that's when he does that.
Yeah.
Do you promise to solemnly swear to be with Susanna in sickness and in health? Now he's looking at that. This is another do like this. And the guy said, I do. Why are you lifting up shoulder? Just say, I do.
Oh, man.
I do. That I do, it sounds like idol. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But when problems come in the marriage, they don't go to the priest who initiated it. He already told them, sickness and in health, better for worse, poorer and richer. They said, I do. Now poverty has come. They are looking for breakthrough. They are going to finance convention with another pastor. But they pledged a vow, which means that marriage will serve the God of the priest in the mountains where the wedding took place.
Hi. No wonder.
See that?
Yes.
Now you are looking for the God of another ministry to solve, to help you solve. And the God of the mountains is saying, they married in my place. I'm the God of that place. Some of you now begin to think, oh Lord, brother, if you know our own story, it's long ago. Three pastors officiated my wedding. Only you. And now, they all have to come home. They love us so much. He brought a pastor. He brought his pastor. The parents brought their own, three of them. Mm-hmm. Hey, Pastor Boniface, well, come and start first.
That's true.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
This wedding is the wedding. Oh God, bless you. Bless you. Then they invite Pastor Boniface. Father Lord, we have come to you. Where? In the mountain?
Hi.
We have come to you in this nice place. It was his day, he said, he made us lie in green pastures. What if they found themselves in the desert? The God of green pasture does not come to the desert. The parents bring their own pastor. Reverend Obunayadi. Because all of them came with their gods.
Wow.
And the God of the place, he said, you people came to my own territory with your own gods. So you see why the child, firstborn says, I don't believe in God. Secondborn says, I'm just Libra. Mm-hmm. Thirdborn says, I'm an atheist. I believe in the higher power. Fourth born said, I'm still searching. You know, I'm a free spirit.
Yeah.
Free spirit. Yeah, no.
God
will buy you. If you are free, we'll take. No. That's what we're saying. It's like a joke.
It's real.
That's what is happening in many families.
Yes, today. Yes, sir. It's true.
That their mommy dressing to go to church. Child is sleeping. And yet you call that child a gift from God. Which one?
Wow.
Which of the gods? Maybe the God where you got him from said he should not go to church. You go on your own.
Mm.
Because the God through whom that child came is the God that child will serve. The moment that child says he's serving another God, it's trouble.
Yeah.
Didn't you, God said, I cannot hide these things from Abraham, knowing that he will command his children after me.
Command.
Because the children I give it to him, he will command them after me. Now, the children have been born. He says, now one of you go to Bethel. Go and live there.
Yes, sir.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
To our viewers, if you have not made Jesus the Lord of your life, you have an opportunity to do so. The Bible says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You know, people say, well, but I believe in God. But the Bible says demons believe in God too. But it matters which God they believe in. But demons also believe in God, the Bible says, and yet tremble. Demons believe in God, and yet will still go to the lake of fire. Demons have believed in God long before you were born. James chapter 2, verses 19 says, demons believe in God. And yet they are eternally condemned. So believing in God right from when you were a child will not take you to heaven. Somebody said, but I believe in Jesus. Well, that was before Jesus died, going by John 3:16. As a matter of fact, when Jesus came, you and I were not born. So you didn't live to see him. How can you believe in the one you have not seen? But you see what God did? God decided to create a provision that if only we will believe his resurrection, knowing that we did not live in his day, he says, if thou shalt believe the Lord Jesus, if thou shalt confess the Lord Jesus and believe that God raised him from the dead. That's what we are now believing. We are no longer believing in Jesus according to John 3:16. We are now believing the resurrection. Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10. That's what we've been commanded to believe. To believe that God raised him from the dead. Someone said, what would that do for me? Believing that resurrection is what will make you righteous. It's not the good things you do that will make you righteous, but believing that resurrection is what will make you righteous. He said, with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. Romans chapter 10, verses 10. With the heart we believe unto righteousness. And what do we believe? The resurrection. Someone said, well, how about the confession of my sins? The Bible never said if you confess your sins, you'll be saved. A lot of preachers say generically, but it's not true. It's not in the Bible that if you confess your sins, you'll be saved. Rather, it says, if we confess his lordship, we'll be saved. That's what the Bible says. Confession of sins only brings you healing. James chapter 5 verse 16 says, confess your faults one to another, pray for one another that ye may be healed. Before Jesus healed the people, he will say to them, your sins are forgiven thee. And the forgiveness of sins requires the confession of sins. You see, now, confession of sins only brings healing. You can be healed and still go to heaven. But there's one name we've been commanded to confess, which is far greater than any sin you may have committed that you want to confess. It says, if thou shalt confess the Lord Jesus. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Calling upon that name is far greater than any sin you want to confess. We'd like to include your indulgence to acknowledge the Lordship of Jesus today. We'd like to include your indulgence to do so. Alright, so Romans chapter 10 verses 8 to 10 tells us that. Say these words and mean it with all your heart. Then you know that you know that you know that you are saved. And if anything happens to you, you know exactly where you are going. Say these words. Say, Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
Say it like you mean it. Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
I thank you for your Son, Jesus.
I thank you for your Son, Jesus.
My Lord.
My Lord.
I call him Lord.
I declare him my Lord
because I believe He rose from the dead for my justification. And at this moment, I confess with my mouth that
Jesus Christ
is Lord of my life from this day forward to the eternal glory of God my Father. Amen and amen. If you have just made that declaration, we would like to congratulate you and welcome you into the family of God. And we would like to pray for you right now. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your son and your daughter that have acknowledged the lordship of the name of Jesus. Your word says, whosoever cometh unto you, you will know why is cast away. Even as this one have come unto you, having believed that you raised him from the dead. Lord, may these ones never be a castaway. May their feet never slide. May these ones not backslide. Lord, may their lives be full of testimonies. And may these ones never go to hell. Holy Spirit of God, we ask that you put your seal upon them. And at the end of the day, may they make it in eternity with you. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Shout hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Let's say congratulations to them.
Congratulations!
Amen. Shout fire!
Fire!
Amen and amen.
Amen.
Well, let's prepare our offering.